Someone who's held senior leadership roles in sales, marketing and business development in Fortune 500 companies across India and Asia Pac in consumer goods, telecom and technology. Ladies and gentlemen, you've seen him on stage before in past editions of In Store Asia, and it's wonderful to have him back on board. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together as we welcome on the stage Mr. Lloyd Mathias. Good afternoon, sir. Welcome. Can we please have our moderator mic'd up? And, well, we've got our panelists ready to make their way onto stage. This is going to be an exciting one. So, ladies and gentlemen, up first, we're going to welcome Amita, Karwal, Managing Director, India, HH Global. Please put your hands together as we welcome her onto stage. Our next panelist is Founder and CEO, Control M Print Management India. Please put your hands together for Huzefa Kanorwala. Good afternoon. Wonderful to have you here. Client Services Director, Sound AMEA, TMS Global, please welcome Paul Khoury. A warm welcome. We're going to get you mic'd up. Up next, Head Category Planning and Activation, Mondelez International. Please welcome Aditya, Krishna. Ladies and gentlemen, Regional Resourcing Manager, Procurement and Trade Marketing, AMEA, Mondelez International. Please welcome Divya, Pande. Our next panelist joining us on stage, Director Renam Retail. Please put your hands together for Ragesh, Bhatia. And finally, joining us on stage, Managing Director, Spectrum Scan Limited. Please welcome Amit, Shah. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we've got our panelists. It is a big panel. It's going to be an interesting discussion, should I say debate. And as the stage doesn't stop here, it's everybody's going to be a part of this. Please, once again, a loud round of applause for all our panelists. It's going to be a total of 40 minutes, which is about 30, 35 minutes of discussion, and follow that up with questions. So please make sure that you are completely involved in this panel discussion. Our moderator taking us into this session, Lloyd Mathias. Sir.
Good afternoon, everyone. The last session before lunch is, I guess, a little, always going to be a little tight. We've got an interesting panel, very diverse, if I may say. You heard the introductions, but very broadly, we've got roughly three points of view on the table. We've got the client perspective, so there's Aditya from Mondelez, and there's his colleague Divya as well. So they'll talk a little bit about some of the challenges that brands and marketers face when looking at the entire point of sale ecosystem. So I think that's one aspect. Then we have, of course, people from the aggregation ecosystem. So Amita, who represents HH Global, will give a little perspective of the role of the new age aggregators. Say about 10 years back, clients directly dealt with manufacturers of point of sale material and bought them on. So I think right now, we've seen that entire evolution play itself out. And then we have representatives from the point of sale ecosystem, people who make the 2D and the 3D displays, the kind of things that we touch and feel in store. So I think that's the kind of the third point of view. What we're hoping to do over the next 40 odd minutes is really get all these views on the table, find out what are the challenges, what are the issues that brands face, that manufacturers of point of sale face, what is the role of the new aggregators in the ecosystem, and how do we kind of move forward from there. So we want to make this as interactive as possible. We'd certainly welcome questions. Just to kick this off, as a background, I've spent a couple of decades in the marketing space, and I've really seen this business evolve. One is business models are changing. What used to be a simple go-to-consumer model, now there are e-commerces, there are marketplaces. There's a whole change in the retail ecosystem. And even consumer choices and tastes are evolved, right? Sitting on one's bed and flicking through an Amazon and doing shopping versus going to a store, that whole experience is different. So when consumers come to a store, they expect to be rewarded with the whole experience. So I think that part has changed. I'll have Aditya from Mondelez share his perspective. in terms of what his expectations are from this larger ecosystem, and then we'll take it forward from there. So Aditya, would you like to kind of share your perspective?
Sure, thanks for kicking this off, Lloyd. So as Mondelez and speaking on behalf of the industry, I'd say that that the point of buying Firstly is an extremely important investment place for us, because we see that in categories, the percentage of decisions actually made by shoppers in store could range from 50% to as high as 100%. So firstly, the point of buying is an extremely important part of our investment framework, and that's true across industries. Now, speaking about what the expectation of manufacturers is. So first things first, firms like ours are specialists in certain domains. So we are either specialists in snacking or specialists in personal care. What we desire at the point of buying is stunning point of buying displays, displays which stand out, displays which attract shopper attention, and displays which really lead to incremental sales for us in stores. So the primary focus for us is to do stunning point of buying sales. But we want to do this also at scale. So doing 10 displays across the top 10 stores would reach out to 0.1% of shoppers. That won't serve our purpose. What we require is innovation, impactful displays at scale. Who is that, that's a point of buying perspective, but talking about the context of this conversation. As companies move global, we are all seeking forums where we can bring global best practices together. Sure. That there's no point in reinventing the wheel. If something great has happened in South America, for example, there's no point reinventing that. We just want to lift and shift it and implement it in the country. So that's point number two. And three is about transparency. Knowing what are the specifications of the material that you've purchased. What have you received? What quantity have you received? So these for me would be the top three key expectations. First would be impact at scale. Two would be bringing together and sharing global best practices, and three would be transparency and measurement.
Fantastic. I think that's a great way to kick off. I think what Aditya told us early was the fact that they need impact and scale. Large brands need that. They want to delight the consumer. I think they need their global best practices to get translated on the ground at the retail front. And they need clear, transparent metrics. I think the pressure for marketeers, for companies on realizing the value of every invested rupee, every invested dollar is critical. So I think bringing that aspect is something. Amita, as someone who's seen the industry evolve, and you've been one of the pioneers in terms of, she leads HH Global. So do you want to share your perspective of, how this whole client interface has changed, and also your relationship with the vendors?
Yeah. Taking off from what Aditya said, I agree, and I think I've seen the evolution in the similar lines to start with. What was earlier a very transactional, commoditized relationship, I want this and get this done and this is delivered, I take it at the best and the lowest price, or the lowest price, and I move on. That existed for many, many years. And then in the last 5 years, there has been, thanks to the changing retail landscape, there has been a change in the dynamics and the expectations. So from our perspective, we see that the clients, when they talk to us, the first thing is, of course, transparency. That is the first part, as well as enhancement and optimization of the complete supply chain process. That's the first thing that's required, because you need to see how the whole funnel is moving. Where is it going? Where do you start? Where, once you sign off, how do your actual delivery happen? Where does it happen? And what you see is what you get. That's the first thing. And that has somewhere become a hygiene and something that we need to do. That's where we play a very critical role. Added to that, we've seen that the need for innovation has grown. Now, innovation from our perspective, what we've seen our clients saying is that, and what they are demanding is, innovation doesn't just mean that it has to be one piece of a disruptive display. It also means a material innovation. It also means a design which can fit a certain space. So there is an optimization in an innovative way. And that is something that we work hard now on. So design has original design, looking at new ways of optimizing design, as well as disruptive design and bringing in what's going on today in the real-time scenario, whether it's a digital immersion that you're looking at, is the other thing that we are looking at when we are doing it for our clients today. So that's a very key part of the overall expectation from us. Also, as we see moving forward that, you know, things will change where we see ourselves playing, clients are expecting us to play a role, step back and look at the shopper journey. Understand, like Paru just spoke, you know, what happens in the store, there are multiple touch points. Now, are we touching every point? Are we putting the right display at each point? And that's where we've started stepping in and playing that role and saying, yes, this is working. This what works from a design perspective, mm-hmm. this works from right. a disruption perspective. Right. So that's the other part that we sort of started getting into from an okay. aggregator perspective.
Okay, thanks Amita. I'll just take this across to Ragesh. I just want to get your thoughts. Do you believe that, you know, your earlier relationship, I mean, you had a set of your clients, you'd call them and
right.
you've got some ideas, you'd work with the brand managers, with the product managers, you'll create interesting displays.
Right.
Are you seeing a weakening of this relationship now that you've got third-party intermediaries coming into play? Do you see a kind of a little loss in terms of the speed of execution?
I think
in
so.
In terms of the you know, the innovation impact?
Definitely, I see that things have changed over the last 20 years. So when we started off very long back, we used to directly be in touch with the brand. And you know, it's any design is always a co-creation. So the more we are in touch with the brand, the more we understand what you need and the more we can react very quickly. So when there's an interface in between, there's a loss of communication. It's like a Chinese whisper. So very often when you're going through a layer, we end up giving you something and there are many, many more iterations. So your speed to market goes down, our investment into design goes up, it's a longer process. And honestly, it's as good as the interface in the middle. Now we find there are some people who are very good at passing the ideas up. And it's a person-to-person thing. So it also depends on, you know, how good the person is from the agency who's in between. Is he able to convince somebody about a new idea, or he just takes the brief and comes down and says, no, I want it black because black means luxury. And sometimes you can do luxury in a different way, which may not be black, which is more disruptive. But the brief he's got is that, no, we want a black display because it's luxury. So we find
you
ourselves sometimes...
need to raise
sometimes,
your pitch a bit.
I'm sorry?
A little louder.
So we find sometimes it's restricted because when the brief is percolated down, we're not able to enhance the brief from our side. Mm-hmm. And what I also find is that, see, design is an investment. Mm-hmm. When we invest into design, like you want stunning displays, yes, it requires a lot of effort from the side of the agencies, the producers, the you know aggregators. So are we getting a return on investment on design? There's no guarantee for that. And that's something where we've cut back on design as a company. And I think we found that it's not always sure that you're going to get it. So when we decide to partner with clients, they say, yes, we'll work together. Definitely we'll throw five, you know, six designers if needed. But we found that we are investing a little bit less in design because we find it easier sometimes to just code for it because we have the infrastructure for production. And it just kind of works out better that way commercially, because having you know, a design strength may not always pay off.
Perfect. Yeah. Okay, great. Thanks, Rakesh. I'll just take this across to, well, the only Aussie we have on our panel, that's Paul. And what I'd like him to kind of share a little bit, this is a young company, it's about 3 years old, so Total Marketing Asia. So I'll have Paul share his perspective, and also where do you think there are aspects that India lags in this entire point of sale ecosystem. So Paul, feel free.
Thank you. Where would I start? Oh, well, it is an exciting time for TMS Global. We are the provider of choice for point of sale for our partners at Mondelez globally. Which question would you like me to answer first?
I think one is, what are the big opportunities or the issues or the challenges you see in India in this entire ecosystem as one? And what is it that you as a, I mean, your company and organizations like yours will seek to address?
Well, I think the first word that comes to mind is relationships, because it needs to be on, not there's a, to me, there's ultimately a focus always on the relationship with our partner client, right? But that it's equally a fine balance with our supplier partners. As I met so many of them yesterday and got to engage with them. It needs to be respected on both sides. It needs to be a fine balance because it forms the backbone to who we are. As a young company, we get to set that culture ourselves as of now. And what that ultimately means is we use those relationships, we couple them with process, and then we work with the, specifically, as Aditya said, the global sharing practices is where I think we could get better. Now, I would never presume to tell anybody in this room what I think that we lack. However, what I do think we can do better is share some of the innovations we do globally faster. Okay. And I think that TMS Global is going to work very hard in that space, as well as, you know, we do what we do, which is core, point of sale, and we do it globally. We are set up in 43 countries. How do we use that footprint? And what we do is, we were talking about this yesterday, and I was saying, well, the rest of the world needs to know what you're doing here as well. It's not just about leveraging what global best practices are coming in. We can get that quickly, and that's almost an expectation on the market, thanks to the media. Mm-hmm. But through our communications network, we can also move what our partners at Mondelez India are doing around the world much faster.
Absolutely.
And share global best practices almost immediately, as soon as they happen. I think that's something we can constantly get better at.
Okay. Mm. I'll come back to you separately, Paul, with a question in terms of, you know, things that we can do on metrics, how do we measure the impact later.
Certainly.
But I'd first like to, you know, get Huzefa's point of view in terms of, I think Ragesh made a little bit point that maybe the speed of execution or innovation, we may lose some edge. Do you see similar trends in the relationships that you've had in your journey, you know, on print, working with clients and now working with agencies?
Just 2 points to that. One of the reasons why clients use us is probably designs and the speed of executions. So I'll just put it, rather than theory, I'll just put it in practice, sure, how we actually do it. Speed of execution. We started with regional productions. So earlier, I'm just, example, Mondelez just used to print in Mumbai, send it all POSMs to across the country. What we have done is divided that into four requirements. So north, south, east, west. We have created hubs, and that hubs leads to faster time to the market. Mm-hmm. So Delhi production is happening in Delhi, while Chennai is happening in Chennai. Probably earlier, none of the big manufacturers used to have regional capacity in POSMs. What we have done is decentralize that process. Mm-hmm. So that speed to the market is at least 2 weeks faster than what it used to be before. Mm-hmm. So, and also on the designing side, we are not a big agency kind. We won't come with the master KVs and stuff. What we have done is, once the KV is done, we have adapted that into multiple forms. So earlier, customers have three different agencies. One is the translations, one who does the artworking, and one who does the this. So we have integrated that in our portal, and as soon as the master KV is ready, it can be adapted in 11, 13 languages. Just matter of 24 hours. So earlier, that cycle of getting one master artwork adapted into 12, 15 languages, for a marketer used to take at least 2 weeks, 3 weeks. Mm-hmm. What we have done is reduce that to 2 days time. So the speed to the market, the turnaround, it's fine. And what we have done is our designing team is much bigger than the account manager's team. So we really led the whole means right from the once the KV is done, sure, we would do the designing also, and of course we take inputs from the partners. How is it practical, feasible to produce it? And that's how we are doing and running it the show.
Thanks, Huzefa. I'll now just like to bring Divya in. Divya is from Mondelez again, I think, but her role is very different from what Aditya does. I think she does what is called, she's part of the global procurement team. And she handles a pretty large region, Asia, Middle East, Africa, so not just across the countries. And I think one of the challenges I faced as a brand marketer a few years ago was very often you had the direct relationship with your agencies, with some of your vendors, some of your partners to create things. Now you go through this, the elephant in the room in a manner of speaking, procurement, which, you know, is obviously important in terms of buying efficiencies, in terms of standardization, in terms of quality control, and not taking away from that. But it also, in a sense, has kind of distanced the marketer from what he needs to do in terms of creating impact in the market. And marketeers and brands and companies have kind of fought with this challenge over time. So maybe, Divya, you want to explain the kind of value that you bring vis-a-vis the company, which you know is pretty well established, but also in terms of the relationships that you bring with the marketeers and with the vendors, the people who make the point of sale. So sure. Maybe you want to share that perspective.
Sure. Hello?
Yeah, please. Okay.
Thanks for asking the question. So I'll just bring in the perspective, adding to Aditya's point that we are looking to drive stunning visibility and across the globe. Mm. To bring that, I think most important thing, the big question was, what is best in class? How do we leverage the scale? And for that perspective, I think our sales team, we need simplification on the process, okay? For plan and execute so that to create various opportunities so that we reinvest the savings in the growth. For that perspective, we needed one way of working, one sourcing approach. And that's the reason our firm decided to go for MSP, which is terminology we use. Mm-hmm. The full form is Managed Service Partner.
Okay.
Doing full responsibility and taking care end-to-end process management. So over here, we see the key big benefits having this system in place, which brings in a lot of ease of working for the business, basically. So structured processes in place, which actually brings in the operational excellence, you know, wherein we have like dedicated team working from TMS in our of various countries, and you know, they are responsible to manage the process, mm-hmm. Which helps in quality management, which helps in process improvement. And the next aspect is innovation. With having a service partner like TMS, there is access to innovation across the globe because it's one point of contact for us. So it becomes much more easier in terms of managing day-to-day operations. Also, you know, from a procurement perspective, we have to follow the protocol and policies. So for that perspective, if there is a one supplier, it brings in, you know, ease like only, we have to deal with one service partner, not so many contracts required. So it becomes a lot of easier process. And the next biggest aspect, we are just not focusing on, these aspects, but wants to also focus that how can, because for Mondelez, we are driving sustainability a lot. So what is good and bad material? So bringing in those kind of expertise through an expert agencies is really a key. So that's the whole ecosystem, I would say, which we are trying to build. And through that, helping marketers to focus on the marketing and bringing in the process experts to, with the use of technology and people which are having desired capabilities to do the job.
I think it's a great point that Divya is bringing. So I think what she's really outlined is the fact that let the marketer stay focused on consumer insights, on ensuring that his brand reaches out to the consumer. We'll take care of all that interface, the agency relationships, the pricing, the quality, the standardization. And I think there's tremendous value. I'd just like to get Amit from Spectrum into the discussion and what I saw at his, some of the innovation that he's driving using corrugated sheets. So Amit, have you seen your interactions or your relationships with brand marketers come down over the last few years? And have you seen this impact or impede the kind of innovation that you would like to showcase with consumers and brand marketers alike?
So what do you mean by brand marketer?
The brand custodian, the guy at Correct. The company who's out there selling a product in this case.
Yeah. So for us now, that there's a paradigm shift happening because the print buying agency is coming in. So there's less of interaction with the brand marketer. That's why I ask you.
Yeah.
For us, is a brand marketer could be our print buying agency because they take the communication from brand marketer and then transfer to us.
Right.
Naturally, that interface has come in which we have to accept it. So that's a less of interaction. A, what Ragesh says, I support it, that definitely there will be a communication, lack of communication happens sometimes. B, whatever innovations we want to showcase, sometimes it not been showcased to end customer. Mm-hmm. Our focus is always been the customer. Like Cadbury has a customer for us, but we like to see that the consumer is a customer first, how they react in the market scenario. Let me tell you first, we have a huge experience of retail, which is general trade, modern trade is coming up. But understand, India is a very complex. The retail industry is going through a transformation, and we can take the pride in telling you that we have seen the three huge innovations in happening in retail, telecom, and automotive. We are part of that journey which has happened. And the Indian aspirations of middle class is going up, so buying pattern is changing. The shampoos, the sachets, the creams, the face and chocolates, everything is going up and up. You cannot sell whatever you're selling that on last. In my personal experience, rural market is much smarter than us. They value more what we are selling. They have more knowledge than us because of this, all these Wi-Fi free and other things. So we can't take it lightly. So where I'm coming to the point of innovations, we have to come up with innovation which is A, clutter breaking, B, durable, C, vibrant. Because India is a country of colors, noise, lot of complexity, and this has to be part of it. And also as an Indian, we have I take a lot of pride in having Indian roots, that we are touch sensitive. When you go out and buy a bread, we don't buy bread like this. We touch and we feel it is fresh or not. It's a genetic imprint. We can't change it. When I'm buying a soap, though I'm buying the same soap, I smell it and sell it. I'm not telling you that soap scent has changed, but that's my genetic imprint, our genetic imprint. So that is very essential to create innovation which we will connect to. These are the traits of the Indian people. That is my opinion here.
Fantastic. I think great perspective, because a lot of buying is not just about what the brand wants to convey. It's also about consumer receptivity and the fact that, you know, even within a country, people across different regions have their own unique ways of consuming or buying a brand. I'll just pivot this discussion now into this kind of second part, and you know, here's the challenge. I think across categories in India, we're seeing a big transformation, right? Let me talk about a category I was involved with, let's say mobile handsets. Today, at a broad level, you know, mobile handsets, almost 30 to 40% of the business comes from e-commerce marketplaces, right? So consumers who know the brand they want, do the research online, then go to one of their favorite vendors, maybe a Flipkart, Amazon, Walmart, any Snapdeal or whatever, and do the purchase. So that's a huge component that maybe 10 years back didn't exist. Then of course there's the growing, but gradually growing slower, organized trade, right? So the Reliance Digitals, the Chromas, the Vijay Sales, the large parts, they're another 20% of the business. And then the balance 40 is still what we traditionally call the mom and pop stores, right? The individual retail owners who still have a lot of relationships and who still sell a lot of high-end phones. So that whole ecosystem has changed in terms of how consumers are buying. Maybe in FMCG is a time lag. E-commerce is not as big. The Kirana store is still possibly 80% of the core business, but the organized trade is growing. The future groups, the big bazaars, and more fancy stores. What I'd like Aditya to share is that as this buying journey of consumers in India evolves, moving from possibly the more traditional mom and pop Kirana store to the slightly more evolved purchasing at organized trade, how has the evolution of your procurement for purchasing happened? Is point of sale up and center in your discussions with your brand agencies, with your creative agencies, saying that my campaign is not just about that 30-second television spot, about that great YouTube video going viral, but it's about that fantastic store display that's going to make every consumer walk in and say, hey, I want this Cadbury chocolate?
Oh, sure. So, there's been a shift in consumer behavior towards different kinds of channels, you know, what we've seen here also, because India is one of the few fast-growing economies, large-size economies, is that the competition also has intensified in this country. You know, so a lot of brands want to launch over here. A lot of competitors want to establish a play over here. And the approach that most people take today, you know, if a new brand launches in the country, is to go the point of buying route. You know, so while the salience of modern trade and e-com definitely has increased in terms of business, traditional trade remains extremely important still. And the way we've seen our business shifting is that, you know, we've seen, and the industry as a whole as well, you know, if you measure things across the board, the spends in store would actually have grown for most companies. So versus cost pressures across the board. So, you know, there's a lot of conversation in forums like these on costs and the importance of costs for this thing, but the spends would be growing for companies. Two is that it's super important now for point of buying displays and point of buying innovation to stand out and be a source of driving brand imagery and brand preference in stores. So we see a large role for innovation. We see a large role for innovation substrates. We see a large role for technology, not just in modern trade, but in traditional trade as well. So, you know, as I'd say, the times are very, very exciting. The pressure is on marketers to really stand out in stores today and do stuff which has not been done in the past. And that's where I think at a certain point in time, there's a challenge to go beyond what we've been doing before. So say if you've been working a certain way in the past, there's naturally an inclination to go out and explore what's there in the world, what's happening across other markets, what's happening in other sectors as well. You know, I might be thinking chocolates, or I might be thinking beverages all the time. But then there's personal care, there's mobile phones, there's a whole world of categories which I don't have a view on. So looking there for inspiration and innovating in trade is a massive priority for a lot of companies like us.
Yeah, I think Aditya makes a great point, and Ragesh wants to add just a small perspective. I think what he's saying is that today, not only are categories fighting within their own category for increased market share, I think you're also fighting with a larger consumer share of mind. You recognize that technology for young people is so much more exciting. You know, I mean, maybe an Apple phone turns a young person consume much more than a soft drink did about two decades ago. And I think that's the other aspect. So Ragesh, you wanted to add something to what he said.
So just adding to your point on the mobile phone industry, where you're saying that a lot of the buying happens online, the way retail has changed there is that you're trying to build not just a display, but you're building an experience center.
Absolutely.
So what you're moving from is a small display to a complete store. Mm-hmm. And the stores are not getting smaller, they're getting bigger.
Absolutely.
So you'll have your Nike experience store, you'll have your Apple experience store, the Samsung store, I think the largest one now is opened in Bangalore.
Sure.
So people are going, like he said, more into technology, they're going more into experience, they're giving the whole brand perspective. And it doesn't matter where the consumer buys it from, but it's where the consumer experiences the brand. Great. And that's what's important at retail. It's not where you buy it, but where you experience the brand. Because Absolutely. You can buy it anytime, anywhere, you can buy it from your phone, when you're sitting in the bathroom, you can buy it at all. I mean, it doesn't matter. But where have you experienced the brand, and that's what's really important.
I think good point, Ragesh. So it's really the omni-channel experience that you may be going to a store, you're looking at the displays, you're looking at stuff, you're still doing an evaluation on your mobile phone and, you know, looking at, you know, a quick Flipkart comparison and may make the purchase decision saying, I'll go back home and do it. So I think it's the omni-channel experience. But specifically, and this question's for Paul, is as a marketer, you know, a few years back, I used to run sales for a soft drink company that remain unnamed. I think one of the challenges we had was that if you can measure your share of shelf space, it roughly translates into your market share, right? So market after market, we hold our bottlers and our salespeople responsible, saying that if you have 60% of the shelf space in this particular guy's cooler, then that's your market share. So do you have kind of metrics that you think in India we still need to, kind of evolve into to have a better understanding of whether our point of sale money is being well utilized? Because a big challenge for a brand marketer, and I'll come to Divya in a while, is that a lot of your money is spent. You know it's money well spent, but you don't know what part of it is working. You know, so it's like the old advertising maxim, you know, advertising works, but I don't know which part works, and a lot of my money is wasted. So are there any better metrics that you could share from elsewhere in the world?
It's a big question, because I think data and metrics is a big subject. I would say that our role, first of all, is to provide as much insight through data to our partners and let the people who do their job better based on that data. It's very important that we provide a value add in that part rather than substitute our opinion for it. Don't get me wrong, TMS is a person's business. It's a people business. We've got some incredible talent globally. We need to draw on that and bring that knowledge in. But ultimately, it's about providing all the information to our partners for them to make the decisions. It's about insight for me, really.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Amita, would you like to come in and share, you know, what does HH or, you know, what does organizations like yours do to make this evolve better or, you know, to make metrics far more firmer?
So, you know, taking again from what has just been said, ROI measurement, I think, is still at a very, very nascent stage in this landscape, retail especially. I don't think we have sufficient data capture, or if that exists with marketeers, because everybody's caught up in so much priorities, it doesn't get transferred to their partners like ourselves, which we are working closely with. So when we come to ROI, to say tangibly how much has converted and how much of my X dollars has worked to deliver me 30%, 40% additional incremental or just the same, there are no clear-cut numbers which are there or measures which have been derived yet. Mm-hmm. But I think those conversations, because there is investment which is going to go into scalable innovation, digital immersive technology which we are talking of, data has to come in. It will start playing a role. We are a little away in the sense we are still grappling with too many realities and come to sort of understand where do we start from, from our perspective as well as from a marketeer's perspective. And we do have our partners who are giving us solutions today. So metrics measurement, ROI is something that we are still sort of evaluating. Globally, having said that, we have started working with our partner, our clients in the retail space where we are able to do data capture. We are able to define and say that actually how much of this display is working for you, even to the extent of what kind of a messaging works. So, you know, the other part that we need to look at today also in the displays is how much messaging should you have? How much of that is contextual? Mm-hmm. You know, and is your eye falling at the right place? And should you need to look at actually only 2 points of messages which is actually going to be impacting that consumer's mind space at that time when he's looking at a shampoo? Now that, I think, is something we're still not there with.
Okay.
But we've done that globally, but we need to do that.
Fair enough. Huzefa, you want to add something?
Yeah, just to add, at Control-M, we've already started calculating ROI few of our customers. I won't name the customer, but it was a biscuit launch. They wanted to do around 100,000 countertops, and one countertop was 400 rupees. So it was around 6 crores campaign for that just one unit. What we did is we made a prototype of those items, made 100 of those, and we installed in 100 stores. We were constantly coordinating with the sales team as well as the marketing team. We gave them certain amount of stock. We measured that for over a month time and what's the sales return after putting that unit in. So once that data was captured, the marketing could easily go to the management and tell them, okay, this was X, 100 rupees sales was per week. Now it's going up to 250 rupees per week. So there was a justification that because of this unit, there is a sales uptake, and they were able to convince, and then it's going ahead.
Great example. I'll just take this across to Divya for just one perspective. Again, you know, going back to my kind of marketing days, I think one important aspect we realized to measure the efficacy of a marketing campaign or a particular sales unit was really walking into the back room of the kind of company warehouse and seeing the piles of posters and unused point of sale material piled up there, and these are campaigns two or three seasons old. And to my mind, that was a great measure of the efficacy of a sales manager or a marketing group, right? If you've got ton loads of old POP sitting there, you didn't order right, you didn't utilize right, and effectively you misused company resources in a great way. So Divya, while your focus is on the front end in terms of procurement, pricing, quality, standardization, sharing of global best practices, what is it that you can do to eliminate wastage? Because point of sale is huge, and you know, it's like the TV spots you ran that no one saw, the posters you printed that stayed in somebody's warehouse is bad money, and bad, you know, it's not green, it's not environmentally friendly. So how do you guys counter that?
That's a very, very good question, I would say, because I totally understand that, you know, we do tons of productions, and then, you know, the remaining material, it goes back to the warehouse. So, you know, our organization has, you know, directions in terms of managing those waste as well from a depot level perspective. Mm-hmm. So there is a dedicated team who's working on this particular, wherein there are clear KPIs being set up, how to manage the waste, okay, and how to best utilize those waste. Can it be reused or can it be, you know, further? Sometimes what happens that as a part of the CSR, there are a lot of things which we give it as a part of CSR, you know, redo the branding and give it for the CSR. So we are trying to focus, obviously, very importantly, to make sure, one, is there is less waste, okay? Secondly, if there is waste available, how can we best manage those waste, you know, in terms of utilizing so that it doesn't just be a dead stock lying in the warehouse, because it's a waste money also in a way.
Yeah. Okay. Go ahead.
Just to build over there, you know, most manufacturers like ours or most companies would have sophisticated tracking methodologies to ensure where the material ordered is today. So you know, it might have been a challenge a few years ago, but right now it's fairly streamlined as a process.
Yeah, I just one other point I want to add right now, I think, is in the marketing mix, you're seeing digital grow exponentially. And one of the reasons digital grows is that you can target campaigns almost to an individual level, in a manner of speaking. Unlike point of sale, where you kind of turn on a prototype and pretty much launch it across 400,000 stores. So in this context, given the fact that marketing is getting increasingly about personalization, you know, I'll take this to Amit and maybe Ragesh. What is it that the point of sale industry can do to make communication more personalized? Which means he's marketing a brand of chocolates across the country, but his pitch in Tamil Nadu is going to be different, or with a younger demographic is going to be different. So in a store where you're going to have a predominantly millennial consumer, right. You know, so can you help customize point of sale?
See, what we need to do is we need to see channel to channel. So every retailer that you go to, whether it's a traditional trade, we need to understand the shopper there versus somebody who's going to, say, like a Star Bazaar or somebody's going to a big bazaar. Everyone has different customer profiles. So we follow the shopper. We design it around the shopper. Like, are you buying, are you going to a wholesale? Like, are you going to a metro store? Are you buying somebody? So that would be a different, that would probably be the mother in case of, say, FMCG, or, you know, somebody who's outside a college, which is a very impulse point. So you design accordingly. And I think it all goes into customizing as per the channel. And I think that's the key, more than that. And while you say digital is very, very targeted and customized, I think there's a huge amount of wastage even in digital campaigns. Like, you can go on your social media.
Absolutely.
But again, 50% would be wasted and you wouldn't know which part.
Absolutely.
So I think it's the same in both.
Amit, would you want to add in terms of how can you make it more customized?
Customization is important, but in my opinion, your value proposition is more important.
Okay.
So value proposition, if the customer feels this value proposition is getting it, then he will be more inclined to buy this product in terms of the whatever the I have the aspirations to buy that product for the taste, quality, the size, whatever. If I put it in one line, if I satisfy, that I put it on higher than the customizations. Of course, customization is required, and India is a country of so many languages. First is the language change also. So sometimes we miss big time in terms of language translations also, something which comes in Tamil and something in Gujarati has a different perspective of language. You cannot physically translate actually in verbatim. It will have connections. So these are the small points we sometimes miss it. So these are the points which you are talking about, the personalizations, and as Ragesh and everybody is aware, that digitization is really making this life easier for us to audit it properly. But such a large country, such a extreme demand in terms of the price, performance, challenges, we have to have a parity of cost, quality, and the appeal. If you do on that line, we are a winner.
Great. I just throw it open to the floor for a couple of questions right now. I think you've heard perspectives from the marketing fraternity, from the vendor community, from people who make the point of sale processes happen. You heard from some of the new aggregators in the ecosystem. So there are a couple of questions that you have which is relevant to the larger panel. You're welcome to throw them. And then, of course, most of us are available for one-on-ones subsequently. So the floor is open. Yep. Mr. Wahi has a point.
So thanks. Yeah, very, very, very good session, and good to hear the diverse views. Quick question: since 80% or 90% of the business in India goes through GT, and you made that point, how do you see GT merchandising evolving? Because there's really no shopper experience. Space is tight. You got sachets and this and that, and they're getting bombarded with new categories every day. How do you see that evolving? And is it ever going to evolve, or we'll just continue to just go through this chaotic sort of growth on that?
Aditya, you want to take that?
Okay, want me to take that? Okay, sure. So yeah, great, great question. Firstly, you know, and so, you know, there have been learnings over a period of time on what works in GT merchandising and what doesn't. Examples are about 15 years ago, GT merchandising largely constituted of 2D merchandising elements, which were posters and banners. One would find that the life of a poster in the store is anywhere between 15 minutes to about a day and a half. You know, it's not longer than that. So, you know, you didn't really get the evolution for that, but the return for that. But as you've seen time evolving, there is definitely, see, what one sees is that in GT, purchase decisions are made in stores. You know, it's not like 100% of purchase decisions are pre-planned. Hence, it is important to merchandise in stores, and it's important to be present over there. And most companies have well-established display programs that run in trade. You know, and the fact that those display programs have only gone up in their numbers and not gone down would probably lay testament to the fact that that things do work. What you are seeing an evolution of as well, a trend which is a small-scale trend, but it's evolving today, is the migration of the traditional mom-and-pop stores into a sort of self-service kind of format. So, and that brings new opportunities for merchandising in stores as the migration change is very, the pace of change is quite slow. But that definitely brings with it opportunities for merchandising. So, you know, net-net, it is evolving. You know, a few obvious things that one did in the past, you've stopped doing because of the low efficacy. But for me, there's a massive opportunity on what next to do in GT. So on two or three fronts. So first is on breaking clutter in stores via materials, via substrates, via displays, the way things are. Two is via personalized content, which we picked about earlier. You know, you could have shopper insights based content happening in GT stores. And third is leveraging technology. One space which has been left behind vis-a-vis technology is really the traditional trade store with respect to talking to shoppers. So
great that's question. Narevich. Sorry, Amita and Ragesh want to add a brief point.
Yeah. So really taking off from what you answered and said, that we've also seen that traditional trade is a challenge. And I think the challenge is not going away. It's a huge space. However, what we've tried doing for our market, for our clients, is that we've looked at solutions which are smarter, which is optimizing in substrates, optimizing in design, also trying to break clutter in a smaller way by becoming visible through any space which is available and can be captured in a nice manner and actually can enhance and help the retailer sell the product better. So we've created those solutions and we have started working on those. And there is a lot of work to go in there, you know, and we see that even retailers would need that kind of a support today. So I think the gap there is that we see an opportunities where retailers are moving into becoming self-service stores. So as brands start embracing more and more and helping them come together, we can also move in and play that role of bringing in non-lit solutions. So there are digital solutions, there are lit solutions, but similar solution can be made available in non-lit. We went and placed some displays with lit and we realized there is no electricity, there is a power issue. But you can create that in a smaller format and actually place it so that the consumer can see it and retailer can actually look different next to the, compared to the next guy. Okay. So I think there is a transformation which is happening, a little slow, not visible, but happening.
Sorry, you wanted to say? Yeah,
just to add, beyond just adding some displays in traditional trade, I think the market is moving more towards upgrading the whole store. So we are finding the brands not just putting a poster or your 2D or a 3D display. We are saying that can we rebuild the whole store? Look at the cigarette companies.
Yeah.
I mean, that's a pretty large portion of our business. We upgrade the whole store. We take a kiosk, we make the kiosk in the factory, and we ship it out right out there. And he's got a brand new store, giving the full customer experience. We are, you know, whatever is allowed in the legal parameters. We are also seeing self-service stores being funded by certain brands. When you're moving from a small store, let the brand do the racking for the customer, let the brand do the signage, let the brand give the experience. It's like a category management, but at a smaller level.
Got it.
So we create the whole store for the brand, giving the look. Besides that, of course, I mean, there's so much pride of ownership now in the store because of the way India is moving.
True.
The retailer does not want to stay at the same brand experience that he's giving, so he's talking to the brand saying that, will you upgrade my store?
Got
he's
it.
Talking to the mobile companies. So,
Sorry, Amit, one brief point because we're running.
So because of e-commerce, these guys have woken up in terms of GT or in terms of these chemist shops and stuff. So what we are proposing that we have a challenge of a, what Amita said, of a backlit job, which is always attract the attention in terms of this clutter. So we are trying to break that solar into the light where the retailer will not have a problem of putting any kind of his cost, though company want to pay them, but still they don't want to use that light, electricity. So we are trying to break that trend. We are showcased here also a small solution. If that gets, in, gets into the mainframe of this general trade, which will have big impact in lit displays, which is going to attract customers.
Yeah. Right. One last question.
Right. Yeah. Especially to Aditya. Aditya, as per my knowledge, that there is a lot of wastage happen between them. Once you manufacture the display and goes to them, implement it in the retail. First question is, what is the percentage of that wastage, A? B, after buying agency coming in the picture, has wastage reduced and what mechanism has used?
Okay. So, you know, I could take the numbers offline, Vasant, so versus giving you these specific numbers over here. So that we'll pick up later. But what we have seen definitely is that the means of measurement are improving. And there is more transparency coming into the picture as well. You know, would we be absolutely perfect? And I'm speaking on behalf of the industry, is that probably aren't absolutely perfect yet. But has technology helped us get better? It definitely has. And this methodology also has of changing the way that we purchase. So.
Okay. Thanks, everyone on the panel. I think that was a splendid discussion. I know there are a couple of questions, and I can see a couple of hands. But we'll do those one-on-ones later. So thanks, everyone. I think a good discussion. And we can speak to those who have questions subsequently. Thanks, guys. Thanks.